Hi, everyone. We are here at the USC Neuroplasticity Retreat in Lake Arrowhead, and we have the great Beth Fisher here, so we are so excited. She is going to talk to you about her PhD student, Yu-Chen Chung, who talked to us today about the benefits of self-efficacy and all the research that she found. So let us all know.
Okay. Hello, everyone. I'm extremely excited to be with these two. But yes, Chen presented her results of her dissertation today. And very exciting research because she's been particularly interested in the idea that there is a discrepancy between what people with Parkinson's disease do and what they're actually capable of doing. So there seems to be what she calls a performance motor capability discrepancy. And we see that all the time. And some of you that have Parkinson's disease have probably experienced this, where you can move absolutely like you did before the diagnosis under certain conditions. So she was particularly interested in studying whether or not if we added a self-efficacy enhancement, could that impact motor performance? And the reason for that is she basically had identified that perhaps part of the reason for this performance capability discrepancy is that people with Parkinson's disease have low self-confidence, low self-efficacy. And that in itself, the interesting thing is that in itself impacts motor performance. So we've tended as clinicians and people with Parkinson's disease, you tend to think it's all due, poor motor performance is all due to the disease itself. But we now know that in fact, it's actually independently due to low confidence. So can we bolster confidence and improve motor learning? And she utilized a very complex balance task. It's called a stabilometer and a stability platform, where you have to balance on this stability platform. And actually, a number of you might have participated in the study, so thank you. You balance on the stability platform, and the goal is to keep it level for a period of time. I think that each trial is 30 seconds long. And it's very hard. I mean, I've tried it. It's extremely hard to do. And what she did was she had one group of subjects that had what would be called the self-efficacy package. So they were told, before they started to practice, they were told, they were given a self-efficacy statement. You can do this, it takes practice, but everybody who practices gets better. Part of that package also included criteria for what a good performance was. And those are two ways in the literature that are known to be ways to boost self-efficacy. So giving performance criteria and the statement. And the self-efficacy group got both. So that was one group, and the second group basically didn't get anything. They just performed the task and got feedback on their time and balance. So at the end of all this, she did demonstrate that the self-efficacy group with a questionnaire, they actually did, the statement did effectively improve their confidence. But in terms of their motor performance, no effect, not at all. So that was disappointing. We looked at that and we thought, well, okay, maybe this is not an approach that can be taken to be able to impact someone's motor performance through enhancing their confidence. Someone who has Parkinson's disease and is dealing with that. But Chen, I was very excited to see in my PhD student, now PhD, that she found something very interesting. There was a questionnaire involved in this, and she found that there were, on the questionnaire, questions related to how nervous people were before they got feedback on the next, on the trial they just performed, and how nervous they were in the performance of the trial that preceded feedback. Did I say that? Okay. They were significantly more nervous than the other group. And she started to think that maybe the nervousness actually attenuated or countered the effect of the enhanced self-efficacy statement. So they're bolstered in terms of their confidence, but then they're really nervous and increased anxiety because they're not meeting that performance criteria. And so she added another group. She added another group of people with Parkinson's disease with enhanced self-efficacy statement, but no performance criteria. And sure enough, they rocketed on the motor performance. So the bottom line was that essentially, as therapists, we want to help people with their confidence in performing something, but do it in a way that doesn't increase their nervousness.
Yeah.
And she actually showed that this same response to the performance criteria occurred in people without Parkinson's disease. So it wasn't that they had Parkinson's disease. It was the package of the enhanced self-efficacy statement plus performance criteria. So bottom line, you know, easy layer to peel off, right? As a therapist, I can enhance somebody's confidence. And if that's going to improve motor capability, I mean, then we got a virtuous cycle going. So I'm very excited, and I love these two. And
and we love you.
I know. I was gonna say. I mean, first of all, I'm just like sitting here and like sitting next to you, and thinking about how much your work and
absolutely.
And you know, your students, now PhDs, their work has influenced what we do every day. And it might even be work that you did with rats on a treadmill, you know, but it really influences it.
I did boost their self-efficacy.
Yes.
My
those
little
rats
mice.
Were confident.
I love those.
They were
mice.
Confident. So, and I mean, this is such a small thing, but it makes such a big difference.
Yeah.
And this is like as little as us, like doing a timed up and go. And maybe we actually don't say a good trial is less, you know, less than 13 and a half seconds. In fact, you know, we say, hey, people who've practiced this do well on this. And there they go.
Right.
And they do better.
Yeah.
So from a therapy standpoint, it's so useful. Like
right.
her study
right.
is so clinically
right.
useful. I mean, and this is the stuff you do. You always do things that to me like are, it. Yes, it's research is very controlled, but we can take the what you studied and like tomorrow
mm-hmm.
and
oh,
put
good.
It into practice.
I mean, it was interesting. One scientist, when we were speaking about this study, said, wait a minute. I mean, these are people that have Parkinson's disease, so they're going to have balance problems. They're going to, and it was like, right, okay, that's, but if I can peel off that layer that has to do
exactly.
with confidence
mm-hmm.
and the demonstration that the lack of confidence itself impacts motor performance, that's something as therapists we can definitely do.
Really powerful.
It's really powerful.
Yeah.
So
okay.
once again, our lives are changed by Dr. Beth Fisher. This happens to me all the
love
time. And I'm so glad you got to share it with us,
yeah.
with our Re+active team and family. And I think this is a really nice way to help get this evidence to, you know, to the world, to our patients, our clients, the therapists that we know and love. So thank you.
No, that's great. Thank you, because that is an excellent point. How many months, years is it going to be before this is published? I mean, you know, that's going to be some time. And so getting the word out there right away is like... It's like
hot
such
off
a great,
the press.
Yeah.
Hot off the press. Not even impressed. No. We thank you guys so much for tuning in, and we are off to relax and make our way back down the hill before the Memorial Day traffic. And we've really enjoyed the weekend here, and we hope you have too. Thanks so much.
Thanks so much.
Bye.